So I'm going to waste no time. We have you here because we have a big problem. It's a problem that impacts us all, impacts our businesses, and impacts us personally. There are not enough women in science and tech. And just to set the stage, 1985, 35% of the women who graduated with their undergraduate degrees in computer science were women. This year, nationally, that number has fallen. This year it was 12%. It's atrocious. It's a travesty. Now, at Harvey Mudd, when you arrived, which, Maria, that was 2006?
Yep.
That figure was around 10%. Today, it is around 40%. The numbers say it. You have a success story to tell, and we want to hear it. We all want to know how to do it. So, Maria, tell us a little bit about what you did at Harvey Mudd.
Happy to talk about it. The first thing I should say, I did nothing personally. It was all done by four faculty in our computer science department. I occasionally gave them small amounts of money when they needed it, but they really did it. So on the other hand, I have worked on this problem for at least 25 years, so it is something that I've worked on at other places. We know a lot about why there are so few females majoring in computer science. Number one, they think they won't like it. Number two, they think they won't be good at it. And number three, they think that the people who major in computer science are geeks who have no life and they don't want to be seen as that. So all you have to do to change this is one, make it interesting, and two, convince them that they're going to be good at it. And then if you can get enough women in computer science, all of a sudden it's not geeky anymore. It's just a great career. So what did the faculty do at Harvey Mudd College? They decided that they would change the introductory course, which was a Learn to Program in Java course, which is pretty standard at most universities and colleges, to computational approaches to solving problems in science and engineering. Now, they also changed the programming language to Python, which is one, more user-friendly than Java, and two, is actually a practical use in industry. But this whole idea that instead of learning to program in order to learn to program in order to solve fun problems, frames it totally differently, because we know that women are interested in computers for what you can do with them.
Sure.
Now, they also...
But Maria, does everybody have to take this course? I mean,
everybody,
even so, that's not the course I would sign up for when I arrived at school.
Yeah, well, you're not... we're a science and engineering college, so at least we have... the reality that every student who comes, and we're about 45% female at this point, up from about 30% when I arrived, every student that comes does like some area of math and science. And you have to take physics, you have to take chemistry, you have to take biology, you have to take math, you have to take computer science, you have to take engineering, as well as a ton of social science and humanities. So at least we have them in the class. Now, there's a really common thing being in a computer science class is that you're in that course, you are nervous about it because you don't like computers, and there is some kid in your class who's almost always male who's been programming since they were three. And this kid is just so thrilled to meet a real computer scientist, because there are hardly any high school teachers that actually know much about computer science, that they go like, and you go like,
kid.
Oh my God, I don't want to be here. So we got rid of that. We call that the macho effect. And so the way our faculty got rid of it is you go up and you say, Jesse, I'm so glad you're in my class. You know so much about computers. I'm sure you don't mean to intimidate all the other students when you talk about it. If we could just keep it between the two of us and talk in private. And it's amazing, you do this once and they stop doing this. And so that was the first thing they did. The second thing the faculty did was they decided to take to offer all of our incoming first-year female students the opportunity to go to the Grace Hopper Celebration of Women in Computing. It actually starts today. It's in Baltimore. That's why I go right after this discussion. And it is like 3,000 women and let's say 45 men. And they are having so much fun and they're so powerful, enthusiastic, and passionate that we know that for our first-year female students, whether they're going to major in physics or chemistry or biology, doesn't really matter. They're going to have a really good experience being there. So this year, we are taking 58 students to Hopper. Now, we only have 750 students in total. We will have the most by probably at least 10 students mm-hmm. of any college or university. It's in Baltimore.
And you pay for that, you invest in
that? We pay for it. Well, it's the easiest thing I've ever fundraised for because everybody wants more women in tech. Yeah. And so this is an easy way to do it. So, you know, the reality is we get our students to take the first course. We make it so much fun that they take the second course. Mm-hmm. And then we make that so much fun that they take the third course. And by the time they've taken the third course, they're going like, oh, I got the greatest summer job because I know how to program. Wow, I guess I could be a CS major.
Wow.
And I can tell you every single female, if they want it, they have like 5 job offers by the time they're starting their senior year.
Wow.
I mean, it's just, it's such an incredible career.
Now, you mentioned a program when we were talking called WITSON. Tell us a little bit about what that is.
Oh, this is my great new initiative. So there's a tiny startup called Piazza in Palo Alto, started by a young woman named Pooja Sankar. It's an online study platform. And Pooja had this idea of let's do a massive online mentoring program. So on Monday, we launched Women in Tech Share Online. We have 19,000 students. We have 550 mentors, and they're talking about everything you can imagine. Should I go to grad school? Should I get a job? I'm in social sciences, and I really want to be in hard sciences. How do I make the transition? There's a section called Name Your Fears, where they're talking about all the things that scare them. There's a lot of stuff about the imposter syndrome. It's just fabulous. It runs for 6 weeks. It's totally free. It's all volunteer, and it's one of the most fun things I've been involved in launching.
Sounds really cool. You know, as I think about the 18-year-olds who show up for class, and granted, they're going to a school that is focused on science and engineering, I can't help thinking about a conversation that I was in this morning, the talent conversation, and Lori Goller from Facebook was there. And over the summer, she had dropped her 9-year-old daughter off at tech camp. And it was in Silicon Valley, and yet there were 2 girls at tech camp. And she was like, you'll have a good time. And she showed up at the end of the day, and the girl was like, it was horrible, don't send me back there. And it just seems to me like when she's 18, she's already had that experience, as have so many young women in our culture. How do you speak to those kids? How do you nurture their love of what you do?
So I think one of the things you have to do is, at least for the moment, I think the best time to start is in college. Because the problem is, even if she had had a great experience as a 9-year-old at that tech camp,
yeah,
the whole culture is swaying young women to say, this is not for me, I won't be good at it. People, I mean, think about Chandler and Friends. Nobody could remember what job Chandler had. Well, Guess what? He did data processing. I mean, he was a computer scientist. So, you know, when I think about, you know, if I could wave my magic wand and have one thing happen, and this is something that there are actually people in this room could make happen. So I beg you, please.
Take notes.
If you could help us get a TV series that shows attractive young women who have lives that are actually working as computer scientists and attractive young men and who are making a difference in the world, because I got to tell you, if you want to make a difference in the world, there is no better field than computer science. It pays incredibly well. You can travel the world. You can have babies. I mean, it really is the best career you could possibly have. And everybody, I mean, if you're smart enough to go to law school or to get an MBA, believe me, you can be a great computer scientist. I mean, it's not the way they say it. It's not some gene that you need to be born with. It's just like everything else, it's hard work. So if you work for the media, please help make this happen. The other thing you can all do is you can encourage young women when they're going to college to take one computer science course in the first year. You can also reward, bribe, whatever, departments that actually make a difference and make their intro computer science classes interesting, fun, and non-intimidating. And there is no excuse for not making them fun. I mean, it's not hard to make them fun.
So when you say make them fun, let's stop on that a second, because is there a difference between fun for men or fun for women? I mean, when you're designing for women, for example, you have to fight the tendency, or at least, you know, when I'm pitched products, make it pink. Women will love that. Can you make a class pink?
No. So here's the deal. Women love puzzles. I mean, sure. There's lots of data that says that women love puzzles. They like crossword puzzles, they like card games, they like all kinds of puzzles.
Yeah.
That's what computer science is. It's solving puzzles. All you have to do is bring out the fact that it's creative, it's fun, it's interesting, and it's not that difficult.
So I'm taking your magic wand away, because yes. Sadly we don't have magic. And
I have magic. Yeah. I work for my magical institution. It's called Harvey Mudd College.
She'll be taking applications after. So how about, let's get practical here. What are three things that this audience can do when we leave here today that are going to help with this situation?
So I think the first thing you can do is you can talk about it. Not enough people talk about the issue. And, you know, it really matters. It matters for the future economy of this country because there aren't enough people graduating in computer science. It matters for the products, the actual and solutions that get made, because if you don't have the perspective of women, I can tell you, you will not have as good products or as good solutions to problems. And it matters because these are great careers. So, one, talk about it. Talk about it, go challenge your local university. Say, you know, most of the women here have some disposable income. Go challenge your local university and say, if you will take your female students to the Hopper Conference, I will help fund that. Or say, if you will redesign, and we share all of the information about our redesign course, I mean, we make it available to absolutely everyone. If you will redesign the course in a way that makes it more attractive and less intimidating, I will give you a grant for $50K. I mean, it's amazing what CS departments will do today for $50,000 because, you know, there's so many cuts in budgets and there's, you know, all of these kinds of things. So you can do that. You can talk to young women and you can tell them that it really is, this is something they can do. Don't tell them to be a CS major, that is a waste of time. Just tell them to take an introductory computer science course. And then that TV series, I really want that.
We'll get on that. I want to thank you very much. And I want, on behalf of our audience here at Fortune, at the Most Powerful Women's Summit, to applaud you for the work you've done in this area.
Thank you.